Right, so hello everybody. My name is Daniel Janus, and today I'm going to talk about natural language processing in Clojure. And this is going to be kind of an experience report. I'm going to talk about some tools that I have built that solve some problems in the NLP domain. And specifically, I'm going to talk about corpora. So let's start with answering the question, what is a corpus? So in the broadest sense, a corpus is just a searchable body of text. And this can be as simple as just a bunch of text files in plain text format that you can just grab through. Or at the other end of the spectrum, the World Wide Web itself at large can be thought of as a corpus that you can search using search engines such as Google or DuckDuckGo. Depending on what you want to do with the corpus, these two approaches can actually get you pretty far, but they do have limitations. They are only feasible to a certain extent. So people are building specialized corpora. In fact, most major languages have their own corpora, which are sometimes labeled as national corpora. There's lots of applications, lots of things you can do with a corpus. So let's see what one might do with a corpus and why one might want to build one by oneself. So the simplest thing you can do is just investigate occurrences of certain words or phrases, or put another way, build concordances for those words and phrases. This is what you do when you search Google, but for instance, this is also something what lexicographers or people who write dictionaries do in order to find real life, real language usage examples for their dictionaries and to give them an extra level of credibility. Another thing you might want to do with a corpus is to narrow down your search only to documents that meet some criteria. And this assumes the existence of some metadata that are ascribed to each document. And for instance, when you have a corpus of newspaper articles in which metadata might include the title of the newspaper, and the author of the article, and the date and the issue number, then you might, for instance, limit your search only to articles written after January 1st, 2016. Another thing you might want to do is to also include grammar in your search. You may want to search not only for the word you type in, but also for all words that are kind of grammatical instances of the word you have typed that are belong to various grammatical forms of the same word. And specialized tools exist to ask for more complex grammatical queries such as noun phrases consisting of a series of adjectives that agree with the noun they describe. And you may also want to extract keywords. And by this, I mean to look at what words are characteristic of a portion or sample or subcorpus of a corpus as opposed to the whole thing. There'll be examples of this later on. There's a whole bunch of more sophisticated statistics that you might want to do, that I'm not going to delve into at the moment. Right, so after this introduction, let me talk to you about the corpus I have built. and tools that I have used. The corpus is called Polish Parliamentary Proceedings Processor, or PPPP, or P4 for short. And it consists of transcripts of proceeding of the lower chamber of the Polish parliament, which is called the Sejm, covering the whole period from the beginning of the current Sejm in 1991 up to the very latest sittings. P4 also includes some supplementary data sets, which is data about members of parliament in each term. There have been 8 terms to date, and also the results of votes or roll calls in the same. P4 has rich metadata about each speech. Each speech is considered a document in P4, and each speech has a term it was given in, the number of sitting, the number of days within a sitting, as sittings typically span several days, the date, name of the speaker, the parliamentary affiliation of the speaker, which typically means the political party that the speaker belongs to, if any, and the agenda topic that the speech in question pertains to. This corpus is searchable by lemmata, which means lemma is a base form of a given word. So each word is reduced to its base grammatical form. The source for P4 is the website of a Polish Sejm. It's sejm.gov.pl. And unfortunately, these proceedings are not available to download all at once. So I have to simulate the workflow of the user downloading the pages one by one, and to extract the metadata by myself. This scraping process, which I will talk about briefly, includes semi-automatic validation and error correction, because I, due to the fact that the data sources in P4 are twofold, it's speeches but also roll call results, I can cross-validate them and find out inconsistencies and have a standard corrections file to apply to them. And as I mentioned, it's kept up to date. It includes the very latest proceedings and can be regenerated as proceedings go, to include even more. So the tools for downloading, P4 is based on Skyscraper, which is a Clojure library for scraping whole sites. And for searching and doing some statistics, I have Smyrna, which is a concordancer or search tool for corpora in Polish that supports HTML files. And then Smyrna uses some supplementary libraries that I will also briefly mention. That's for a lemmatizer for Polish, so a library that converts each word to its base grammatical form. And CLJ and KJP, which is used by Polylum, a library for passing the publicly available subcorpus of the National Corpus of Polish. So let's start with Skyscraper. The tagline I've invented for it reads, structural scraping for the rest of us. And as I mentioned, Skyscraper is a tool, a library for scraping whole sites at once. Based on nlif, and let me ask you a question, who has used nlif? Who has heard of it? Okay, quite a lot. So for those of you not in the know, nlif is a Clojure library that allows you to parse HTML and extract part of the parsed HTML tree using sophisticated Clojure-based selectors that are composable and in a nice way and provide a high level of expressivity. The problem for me with nlif is that it only supports scraping or extracting data from one document all at once. I wrote one of web scrapers for different websites using nlif, and then I ended up writing quite a lot of boilerplate related to caching and downloading data, retrying, and so on. And as I wrote more and more of them, I discovered some underlying abstractions that I realized may be worth extracting to their own library. And that was how Skyscraper was born. Skyscraper handles all these technical details of downloading, parsing, caching data, allowing the user to focus on the actual data they want to scrape, and provides abstractions to focus on scraping. So let's talk about these things I discovered, these insights. The key thing that I discovered is that you can't really just download a whole bunch of pages and then scrape them one by one. So we can don't just wget dash r and then scrape all your local websites in turn. Rather, you want to simulate the workflow of a user that goes through the website in question, clicks through it in a depth-first way, and extracts data as they go. And furthermore, in this scraping tree that appears, there are different kinds of nodes that it need to be processed in different ways. So you can, for instance, have a root page or several root pages that contain links to sub pages that contain a different kind of information that you might be interested in. And those sub pages contain links to sub pages in turn, and so on and so on. And all these levels constitute different kinds of nodes that you want to scrape in a different way. So in each node, you scrape off new information from the current page and attach it to the information that you've got so far from the parent nodes that led you to the page you are currently processing. In terms of functional programming, this can be thought of as a least monad, and we shall see why in a second. And the abstraction that arose, I had to invent some terminology, and I came up with the word context. For a map from keywords to arbitrary data, and context represents data scraped so far. So at any given time, you scrape your HTML, you extract some data that forms a partial context and append it to a context that you have so far. A context has two special keys, URL, which is the URL of the next page to visit, and processor, which is which tells you how to process that next page. And I'll tell about this in a minute. Seed is just the initial context or sequence of initial contexts, and the processor is a single unit of scraping. It's a function that is able to scrape data from one specific kind of node in a scraping tree. The function that takes a current context and then this resource, which is basically a scraped HTML, sorry, a parsed HTML, and it returns a sequence of new partial contexts that are then merged to the parent context and fed into subpages. Whenever there is no URL or processor in the context, that means we are in a leaf node of our scraping tree, and there's nothing more to pass down from this node. Here's an example. The example is actually not from before. It's a simpler example from a parser of a service called Miejski.pl, which is the Polish version of a urban dictionary. So the seed, as you can see, is that just a sequence of URLs that corresponds to letters of the alphabet, and also digits and non-alphanumeric signs. Processor tells you that you want to process these URLs with a processor called letter, which is defined below. Don't worry about the cache template part. I'll explain it shortly. But the processFN is a function that I've mentioned takes the endleaf resource and the current context, scrapes some data out of this resource, which corresponds to pages are corresponding to that particular letter, because the Miejski.pl website is paginated per letter, and grabs the number of page out of that, includes it in a new context, and includes the new URL and the new processor in the context, and so on and so on. And this can be fed to Skyscraper to yield a list of all words that are in the Miejski.pl dictionary. The result of scraping in Skyscraper is a lazy sequence of leaf contexts. So the contexts that have no more URLs or processors in them. And this is nice because it's decomplex scraping from storing the results of scraping. You can either feed it to some kind of a DB or write it to a file, or just ignore the scraping results and just have a local mirror of the cached pages that are side effects of scraping. Skyscraper doesn't care. It has no DB dependencies, although there is a convenient function for writing a script, lazy sequence as CSV. And the benefit of laziness is that it allows you to scrape even huge sites with a little amount of memory, because at any given time you also you only need to remember the node that you are currently scraping and the results of scraping that you have led you to here. And I have successfully scraped huge pages in order of hundreds of thousands of pages in as little as a couple tens of megabytes of memory. To achieve true laziness, I needed to escape chunking. And the funny thing is, I needed to write my own version of Mapcat, because you might not be aware of the fact that Clojure core Mapcat is not fully lazy. It, I think, realizes at least four elements of the sequence, which might not appear a problem, but it accumulates in every node of the parsing tree. So this does not give you true laziness that you may wish for. And also, Skyscraper is able to prune a scraping tree, but by providing restrictions on the context I want to scrape it. For instance, if I'm scraping before, I may say I only want term 8, and at any given time, skyscraper will filter out the nodes that don't match this context restriction. What about caching? I've introduced caching because when you are parsing a huge website, you want to be resilient to problems. If scraping fails for whatever reason, you want to resume it from wherever it was interrupted, and not have to re-download the whole thing. So Skyscraper can cache pages. It actually has two kinds of caches. One of them caching the raw downloaded HTMLs, the other caching outputs of the processor, so partial context. And both of these kinds of caches make sense in different situations. In typical usage, you might want to just keep the output, the context, and not worry about the HTMLs, which saves this space. But the converse is true when you are developing a skyscraper-based scraper, and you do want to recompute the output from our processors every time until you are sure that this is what you really want. So these two kinds of caches, and they have explicit cache keys. This is the cache template that you have seen in the previous slide. So this tells Skyscraper to substitute the colon letter with whatever there is for the letter keywords in the current context, and put it under this key, under the resulting key in the cache. Now, there are multiple cache backends. Typically, without further configuration, this is the file system, so a nice benefit is that you end up having a nicely structured dump of your page structured by directories, even if it originally was not so. And this works well until you start having millions of caches HTMLs, at which point you might want to use some kind of a key value store to avoid having millions of small files, which is why I've created a MapDB cache backend, which is pure Java, so it has no external foreign dependencies. And there's also a null backend that effectively disables the cache. Backends are implemented using protocols. There's a protocol called iCache backend. And the MapDB-based backend is a separate project on Clojure. I have a slide explaining how P4 is built. I'm just going to go very briefly through it. So I first download all these kinds of data with Skyscraper to get structured transcript and speech metadata. Then, because there's more than one data source, I can cross-validate this and detect any assumption violations that might arise. For those, I have a manually managed override series of files, which I then apply to the scraped data to provide clean versions of data, and then I enrich them. So I think that's all for Skyscraper. And let me now cover Smyrna, which is a simple concordance for Polish language text. It's a desktop app, but running in the browser, so the front end and back end run typically on the same machine. It's cross-platform and easily installable and usable by non-technical users, which are the target audience for Smyrna. It's able to build corpora from collections of HTML files, supports Polish inflection, and supports to search for documents in both full text search, lemma-based, and metadata. And it also allows to do simple statistical analysis. I originally wrote Smyrna in 2010. It's this first version only supported very small custom corpora. It didn't have metadata support, only supporting full text search. And the new version that's about to be publicly released, and it's already open source on GitHub, is a from scratch write that can support metadata and can support corpora the size of before, and also has a completely rewritten UI using Clojure script and reagent and reframe. The whole thing is less than 2,000 lines of code, of which 1,200 is Clojure backend and less than 800 is frontend Clojure script UI. Right, so I'll do a quick live demo. This is the first screen of Smyrna, where you present it, where it presents you with a list of corpora it has. So I'll select the same corpus, which has, as you can see, just short of 300,000 documents, and you can see the list of documents in the corpus with their metadata. You have term, number of sitting, number of day within a sitting, date, number of speech within the day, number of points in the agenda, speaker name, parliamentary affiliation, whether the speech was actually delivered or not, and the textual description of the point of the agenda. So I can narrow down this list using either metadata. So I can only, for instance, search for speeches from one particular political party, and I have them. And I can narrow it through terms as well. And full text search works in the metadata here as well. So I'm restricting now the list using the speaker name. And I can also, I'll reset all these filters I've created. I can also narrow down this list by full text search. I search to be for some politically neutral word. I'll say three, which is drzewo in Polish. And the documents I'm given, which is, by the way, nearly instant, is the list of documents that contain the word drzewo or any of these grammatical forms. So I can actually see this in action. I can click on any of these lists. I get the speech in question with the highlighted instances of the word I have been searching for. I can navigate through documents as well. And one other neat thing I can do is I can remember this list of documents I have and give it a name. And I call it an area, which is also in Polish. I call it drzewo. Now I can search for other criteria within only the documents that contain my words. So I can say chef, which means a bush, and narrow it down to the Drzewo area, and I get only documents that that contains both Drzewo and chef. So we have chef, krzewów, and one does two statistical features of Smyrna. One is to build frequency lists of either a corpus of an area, which means to tell me how many times each lexeme occurs in the corpus. It's a table that I can scroll through. And I can also see the keywords as word clouds. I can go here, I pick Drzewo, pick show, and after a second, it shows me a word cloud of characteristic words for this subcorpus as opposed to the whole corpus. So in addition to tree, there's wood, there's wooden, there's environment here, and works like this. And that's about it for the demo. Back to the presentation. I'm going to talk about lemmatization for a couple of slides. So English is easy, right? In English, a verb may have up to four grammatical forms. Now, this is in stark contrast to Slavic languages such as Polish. Do we have speakers of Polish or any other Slavic languages? I know that. Right, so you may know that this same verb can have up to 100 or more distinct forms that each have the same base grammatical form. And there's quite a lot of ambiguity here, since some of these forms here also resolve to other forms. You have to do a kind of educated guesses to determine which base form actually is meant for a given word as it appears in text. So it's called morphological analysis. So each word is converted to a list of its possible grammatical meanings. This is provided by so-called morphological dictionaries. One such dictionary for Polish is Morphologik, which has a Java-based library called Morphologic Stemming, which is used among others by LibreOffice and OpenOffice, I think, as well, and recent versions of Solr. It's a very small library because it has an interim of a compact representation using clever compilers finite state automata-based compression. I'll show you in a second how it looks like, but even though Smyrna is only interested in lemmata, not full grammatical information, there's still ambiguity. So for a word mom, you can have three grammatical interpretations, two of them being verbs, one of them being a noun. You have to somehow determine which of these forms is actually meant. So the approach that Smyrna takes is that it picks the word that's most commonly resolved to in real life. It's not ideal, but it's good enough in most cases, and it's also fast. And for that, in addition to Morphologik, I have a external data source, which is a dictionary of most commonly resolved forms in the manually annotated and thus accurate subcorpus of the National Corpus Polish, which is publicly available in the text encoding initiative format, which is XML-based. So I have two tools, one converting this special XML to EDM and producing a neat Clojure map as a helper for the library Polelum, which is based on that map, on those data, and Morphologic as a second instance to provide base forms of words that appear in texts. The neat thing about Smyrna is that it has a compact on disk representation of corpora. So for P4, it's just over 1 gigabyte of input HTMLs that are processed into one file that's 265 megabytes and is amenable to to easy and effective searching, searching and statistical analysis. Now, the way it's done is that that file is a zip file with no compression, and the trick is that it's the zip format is actually used as a container for different parts in different formats that I can memory map individually. So the main part, the thing that I call corpus image, so the documents, the documents themselves, are actually parsed, compressed HTML trees. So I parsed every input HTML using the CLJ taxo library. Then I serialized the parse tree, which gives me a series of tokens that have the word, either HTML tag or HTML attribute or value or word or special tokens, no space and end. And I apply canonical Huffman coding over the alphabet of tokens that look like this, and there's typically like 500,000 of distinct tokens to provide a compressed representations of the HTMLs. There's now the added benefit of when I'm searching for phrase that consists of more than one word, not overlapping the barrier with between between HTML tree boundaries. There's another part of the large corpus file that holds the index, the inverted index of the lemmata that tells you where, for each possible base grammatical form, which documents, which speeches contain that that form. It's also stored in a neatly compressed way. I refer you to the book Managing Gigabytes by Within a Tower for Details. And metadata is stored as gzipped EDN that is ungzipped and parsed upon loading of the corpus. There's a couple of auxiliary data bits in corpus file as well, like dictionaries of words and HTML tags that are stored as morphologic finite state automata in a compact representation. So the whole thing is pure Clojure, and I just wanted to show you a snippet of a very low level code which handles reading unary numbers from its bit sequences that are backed by a memory mapped long buffer. This is the first time I have used the volatile mutable marked field, which allows you to for your data structure to actually be locally mutable. This code is very self-contained, and the rest of the code is more high-level, and it pretends that all of this is immutable, so it's all sequences. A word about UI, it's written in Clojure script and reagent and reframe. I ended up with all states having one piece and found that it's contrary to my fears, it doesn't introduce any additional complexity, but actually allows to write very manageable and fun to develop UI UI code. And the final word about why custom corpus parsing code, why not just solo theme? Partly because I have not invented his syndrome, partly because maybe it's a playground of ideas, and partly because it gives me very large flexibility to experiment with more accurate methods of lemmatization and other analysis that I may want to do. Key takeaways, you know your design's good when it talks back to you. This is the case of Skyscraper, where after inventing this concept of context and processors, I ended up inventing ways of expressing different kinds of scraping things that I originally thought not possible. True laziness is nice, because it allowed me in Skyscraper to decomplex the output from storing it. And you can go down to a very low level code in Clojure if you need to, and don't need to use Java. All the libraries I was talking of are open source, available from their respective GitHub repos. And I don't think we have time for questions, so thank you.